Good evening. I'm James Goodale, and you're watching the Digital Age. Did the GOP steal the last election? And what role did those voting machines, which are all digitalized, play in that activity by the GOP? That's the question we want to discuss tonight. And here to discuss it is, first of all, Ed Rollins.
Nice to see you.
Nice to come by, Ed Rollins, former political director for the Reagan White House. We could say he was then the Karl Rove of the White House, but that might be insulting to Ed. I don't know.
It would be.
But he was.
Sounds like an insult to me.
And here for the star of this evening is Mark Crispin Miller. He is the author of this book here, which I want to show up on the camera. Yeah, Fooled Again, How the Right Stole the 2004 Election. So, how did they?
Well, I guess the most appropriate word to use would be overkill. Every trick in the book and a bunch of new tricks, too. And I want to make clear that this kind of thing is by no means new in American history. This wasn't the first time an election was stolen. And it's also the case that it's gone on both sides forever. I mean, I'm from Chicago, so nobody has to talk me into believing that Democrats can steal elections. I'm an independent now. But I think that even in the rather sorry history of election fraud in the United States, what happened in 2004 was staggering, unprecedented in its scale, in the sophistication of a lot of the devices used. Never have electronic touchscreen machines been used in more places and more effectively to erase votes than in any other race. And even as we sit here and speak, these machines are finding their ways into many other states around the country, usually against the will of grassroots groups that are trying to prevent it. I would not say that the use of the machines was the only means whereby the race was thrown to Bush, but I think that it's one of the most important and one of the most dangerous, because this kind of fraud is undetectable.
Well, we want to pick up the digital issue with those machines, because I found, in getting ready for the show, the information about these machines very surprising. But if we just hold that off for a second, I want to come back to the very beginning of your book, in which you say, if you look at the exit polls, and you look at even the election polls, and you put them together with the margin of victory, the two don't comport at all, and that leads you to conclude in some part that there's something wrong with this election, and then you go along to explain it the way you have. But let's go back to the very beginning.
Okay.
Can you give me your views on that?
Yeah, it's not just the exit polls.
Yeah.
The exit polls are certainly troubling. In five states, four of them swing states, Kerry ended up losing by the margin he was supposed to win by. And that's something that never really happens. In fact, in the Ukraine, we took the side of the dissidents on the basis of exit poll results, because exit poll results are celebrated for their accuracy. It's sort of the gold standard of polling. Now, in this case, what happened was there was this discrepancy between the exit polls and the official numbers. So Warren Mitofsky, Mitofsky Edison, the company that was hired by the media to do the exit polls, just revised the exit poll results so that they would suit the official tally, which seems to me to be...
Really?
Yes, that's exactly what happened. But the exit poll datum is only one of a broad range of anomalies.
Right.
That lead any responsible person of whatever party would have to take a sober look at the numbers and see that they don't really add up, either demographically or mathematically.
So let's talk with you about this, because not only were you the political advisor in the Reagan White House, but you are a well-known campaign advisor, and you look at polling. Mm-hmm. And I know you followed this last election closely. What do you think about Mark's point that the four or five states were the key states in the election had anomalous exit polling results?
Well,
how do you look at that?
First of all, I think it's important to talk about the overall picture of this
yeah,
election.
Exactly.
There's never been more money spent by both sides. For the first time in history, and particularly since the federal election law went into existence, both sides opted out. There was $1 billion spent. For the first time, there was unlimited resources for television, unlimited resources for ground game organization. Both sides had equal amounts of money. So it was like a nuclear war with all the weapons you could possibly have. Equally as important, for the first time in a long, long time, there was a voter parity. It was 37% by exit polls or any other measurement. Republicans, 37%, Democrats. Prior to that, it had always been a 4 or 5 point advantage in the two elections to the Democrats. And the third factor was conservative to liberal was a substantial difference. It was 34% who identified themselves as conservative voters, 21% liberal, which was a gain of 5%. The other part was there were targeted states this time. Half the country didn't have an election. By the end, there were about 13 states where everybody fought the battleground. And so to a certain extent, there may have been election fraud in certain places. I won't concede the election in any way, shape, or form. What I will state is that there was more effort on the ground than any place, any time in my 40 years in American politics. I don't buy into the premise that there was this giant conspiracy. You have to understand that elections are run by local county people, and it's not Republicans or Democrats, and sometimes they're independents. There's 7,000 separate county operations. But I think the critical thing in this election, which was run over exactly the same map as 2000, there's only three states that changed their voting pattern this time. There were a lot of things that happened, a lot of money being spent, and anytime there's a lot of money being spent, there's a lot of room for mischief. I'll concede that.
All right. Well, let's go to the mischief point. Let's pick up where he ended.
Okay.
There was a $3 million, probably a $3 million difference, but a 3 million vote difference. Mm-hmm. I think that surprised most people, that margin, because the previous election had been so close. How would you explain the 3 million vote difference?
Well, let's look at that question, take it in a broader sense.
Yeah, sure.
We're told that Bush won 11.5 million more votes this time than he got against Al Gore. That strikes me as incredible. First of all, Bush's disapproval ratings were quite high for an incumbent president. They were in the mid to high 40s. Second of all, the Democrats were very strongly unified in a way you don't often see Democrats be. Ralph Nader pulled 400,000 votes nationwide. Third, the turnout was really quite high by American standards. It was over 60%. And in states like Ohio and Florida, the Democrats outdid the Republicans by as much as 5-1 in registering new voters. Now, added to this is the fact that while the Democrats were unified, the Republicans were not. It's true that the exit polls suggest, parity, as you say, but exit polls don't tell us how many Republicans showed up to vote in the first place. Bush lost a lot of Republican support. He lost 60 newspapers that had backed him in 2000 against Al Gore. Now, 60 of them came out against him. The Economist came out against him. The Financial Times came out against him. And eminent Republicans like Bob Barr and John Eisenhower and Doug Bandow and Francis Fukuyama, a lot of people like this, actually went public with anti-Bush propaganda, op-eds and so on, basically arguing that Bush is not a conservative. On conservative grounds, these people said vote for Kerry or sit it out. All that together suggests to me that it's just impossible to believe that he won by 11.5 million more votes than ever before. Now, we're told that it was the result of an outpouring of evangelical support. All right, we were told all throughout the campaign by Karl Rove that there were 4 million evangelical votes that Bush didn't get in 2000, and that was their aim to get those 4 million votes out. Let's pretend that they did that, which I think is a stretch, but all 4 million came out for Bush. That still leaves quite a few unaccounted for.
So therefore, when you look at the statistics, you say it's statistically improbable. I want to get to Ed, but very quickly, there are others who come to the same conclusion who are even more scientifically apt at this particular thing than the normal person, namely those around the table are. Isn't that correct?
Yes, it's absolutely correct.
So it's not, people might say, that's Mark Crispin Miller again.
No.
He's being outlandish, but there are others who have looked at. So let me ask you, Ed, I want to get to the dirty tricks part, but 3 million votes. If you were to say in two or three sentences, how did he win the election? Where are those three million?
Well, first of all, it was substantial. That was just in the raw numbers.
Yeah.
Because of the population increase, there was substantially more people who voted in this election, just in the raw numbers. Throw polls aside,
that increases whatever gets increased.
They're talking in terms of, you know, he has the most votes ever. Yeah. I mean, the Bush team did a very effective job of spinning this as a landslide, and it really wasn't a landslide. It was a marginal win and a good win. And I think a fair win, but they basically said they had the most votes ever in history, beat Reagan's record. Well, you know, that was 20 years ago, and there were substantially fewer voters who voted. The polling that you're dealing with, the exit polling, was a mess. It was a mess in 2000. It was a mess again. And I think to a certain extent, all the adjustments that were made, there were a whole lot of us at 6 o'clock who were running around here thinking that that Bush had lost, and much of that information was coming from the network polling. And clearly, as the states started coming in, the numbers didn't match up. You know, polling is an inexact science. It always has a plus or 3 or 4% in any polling, and I think exit polling is proven to be less effective in the last couple of elections than it has historically. So I think the reality is, you know, I think Bush targeted his states more carefully. Florida is a perfect example. He got 36% more of his vote out than he did in 2000. His brother was governor. They got their guard down in 2000. Kerry had 23% increase in Democrats. So this is a substantial increase in the raw numbers. And they had the resources to do that. So, you know, at the end of the day, a state like Ohio, Bush's margin was smaller than it was. There may have been more registrations and all the rest of it, but it was a state that Bush had a big victory, a couple hundred thousand last time. He won by 116,000 this time. So I think the reality is that there were a lot of mechanical things that occurred, grassroots things that had not occurred on either side in a long, long time, and I think that increased the number of voters.
Let's talk about the dirty tricks. You obtained some notoriety in Christy Whitman's campaign, in which you said what?
What I basically said in a perfectly legitimate conversation with reporters is that we had walking around money, which is perfectly legal in New Jersey, and we used it. And Florio had run out of his money. It was a publicly financed, so that became a big controversy. This time, Corzine was rewarded by the black ministers of New Jersey for giving $4.1 million to their charities. He received an award. I said we had $250,000 for walking around money, and I was basically almost indicted for nothing that was illegal. So, you know, it's walking around money is part of the game. There's nothing illegal or improper about it. Unfortunately, Election Day is payday for a lot of people in America. They have their hands out. You want me to run my organization? You want me to run this? And there were the resources to do all of that in this particular campaign.
Okay, now let's pick up on that and go to this infamous character, or maybe famous character, depending on your point of view, who springs from the pages of your book, about whom I never heard anything, whose name is Nathan Sproul.
Sproul. Yeah.
Now, Nathan Sproul, according to you, received $7 million from the Republican Party, and mostly for, if I understand what you're saying here, nefarious activities.
Well, yeah, it was over $8 million.
$8 million.
And the significant thing about that is that half of that money was fudged. I mean, any independent prosecutor would probably be interested in looking at how, say, $2 million would be earmarked for next year. We spent this all on lodging and transportation. We spent it all next year, you know, this kind of thing. So officially, Sproul got something like $4 million, but he got almost twice that much. And he got it from the Republican National Committee. And what Sproul did was to operate a phony opinion polling operation in at least six states that we know of, including Ohio. He would have people pose as, you know, we're interested in saving the whales or something like that. And then they would, their aim was to sign up as many Republican voters as possible. I think they got paid a kind of bounty.
So they were registering voters, were they?
They're registering voters, not pretending not to be a voter registration outfit, and certainly pretending not to be a partisan outfit. When they signed up Democratic voters, the office would throw those away. And some of the people working in the field, in order to make more money, I guess, sometimes changed people's party affiliation surreptitiously. Now, what's as significant as the MO here, this kind of stealthy operation, is Sproul's background. Nathan Sproul was head of the Christian Coalition in Arizona and was very heavily involved in that state's Christian effort to take over the Republican Party. He then became the head of the Republican Party in Arizona. In other words, he's not what I would consider to be an authentic conservative, by which I mean someone whose main concerns are limited government, fiscal prudence, and so on. He had a religious agenda. I think this fact speaks to a great extent to a lot of the grassroots stuff that went on, because there was a sort of crusading spirit out in the grassroots. People felt it was their holy duty to prevent the demons from winning, you know, whatever, at any cost. At any rate, Sproul did this thing. He was paid by the RNC through December, which suggests to me that he was involved in the subversion of the court-ordered recount in Ohio, because that recount never took place. And then he ended up going to Bush's Christmas party. I think there is still an investigation into Sproul's activities ongoing in Oregon. Otherwise, it's a crime that, you know, no one's talking about. And believe me, this is not a partisan issue. This is a civic issue. If I were sitting here having written a book about how the Democrats had pulled this off, I'd still be sitting here talking about it. I think our system is at serious risk because of both parties, frankly.
Were there more dirty tricks in this election, let's say by the Republicans, because that's who I was worried about, and particularly Sproul? Does the Sproul operation surprise you?
I don't know the gentleman, so I can't, and I certainly am not going to challenge your charges, because I don't have any evidence. I was not involved in this campaign. A lot of what occurs in modern day campaigns on both sides is what we call advocacy calls or what have you. And once again, there was the resources this time to have the grassroots stuff, and you may call someone and you may ask them, are you supportive of this, and it's a method that I don't particularly like. You call elderly homes and you say, are you on Social Security? Do you know that George Bush is against Social Security? And that basically creates chaos. I think one of the things that's missing in all of this discussion is Kerry's lack of putting together a sufficient campaign to make his case against George Bush. He certainly had an opportunity, and I think there's an awful lot of Democrats who would sit here at this table and say in the closing days of this campaign he did not make the case. There was disappointment on the Gore campaign, but there was even more disappointment in the Kerry campaign. And all the mechanical stuff that may have gone on or not gone on, I don't think made any difference. I think at the end of the day, and I think the disappointment that a lot of people had is this was an intense fought campaign, and Kerry did not make the case to beat Bush. When there are a lot of people unhappy over the war, a lot of people unhappy about a variety of things. 4 years ago, when Karl Rove made the challenge that 4 million of his Christians that he was measuring didn't turn out, a lot of that was viewed as there was a drunk driving charge made against Bush late in the campaign, and a lot of people were disappointed. And you know, you can sort of track the patterns of where you think people are going to turn out and they don't turn out. That occurs in all kinds of campaigns. I think at the end of the day, Kerry did not make the challenges effectively. He did not roll out his vote in the way that a lot of Democrats had hoped. And I think at the end of the day, Bush won this election fairly. I'm not arguing that the tactics that you say went on did not go on. I'm just simply saying that the margin of victory was increased because the voter numbers were increased, and I think the Bush campaign ran a much better campaign.
Let's talk about the voting machines.
Okay.
This is a pure digital issue, because what happened after Florida, and maybe even before, but mostly after Florida, is that we ended up with digital voting machines, optical, you know, press the picture.
Touchscreen machines.
Touchscreen machines. And everyone thought we were going to be better off. Now, you have said, and I will say that looking at what other people say, and they agree with you, that these machines aren't what they cracked up to be. And particularly, there's a particular problem for the electorate in that the machines are built by Republican companies, Diebold being one of them. And there apparently is no way that you can audit these machines. I found this very surprising.
Yes, well, let's put it in less partisan terms.
Yeah, okay.
The problem with these companies is that they are private vendors that refuse to make their programming codes publicly available. They say it's proprietary information. This makes using them exactly like having a secret vote count. You cannot really audit them. There's no paper to look at. There's no ballot or anything. Now, the fact that they are private vendors and that they are so reluctant to show what they're doing and what kind of codes they use and so on is particularly troubling when the parties involved, when the voting machine companies happen to be close to one party or the other. In this case, it is the Republican Party. The three biggest companies that make these touchscreen machines, Diebold, ES&S, and Sequoia, all have very long-standing, very tight connections to the Republican Party. They're highly partisan entities. There's no reason on earth why that should be tolerated in a democracy. My view is that we should return to paper ballots, and we should have a ban on the participation of all private vendors in the electoral system, particularly those that refuse to divulge their programming codes. You're smiling.
I'm smiling. This is programs the digital age.
I know.
It chronicles the great flow of history of present time, which is influenced in some part by digital technology. Now we have a big problem, a national problem, and we seek to solve it with a digital solution. And you say, no, we want to go back to horse and buggy. I can't believe this. Is this what we've come to in this country?
We can't count votes? I would hope. Well, first of all, we have difficulty counting votes. And I think that one of the points that I would concede and what I'm amazed by after 2000, our election process is so important to us as a country that's trying to promote democracy around the world, that I've never quite understood why this is. And maybe as a Republican, this is heresy. You know, these elections aren't run by states. They're not run. These are federal elections that are run by county organizations. And I've never quite understood why the federal government didn't decide this is so important. And there is not a parity. We demand one man, one vote, but there's not a parity. Some states can afford the best technology. Some can't afford. Some counties can afford the best technology. Others can't. There still are a lot of paper ballots, and there's faultiness in that. I can't understand why every decade the United States doesn't basically say, this is an investment. We're going to make a grant to states who in turn can make grants to counties. And we have a system-wide methodology that is digital, and there is a methodology to it, and whoever bids on it.
But what do you take about it? I mean, none of us are digital experts, and I even include myself. I know a little bit from doing this program, but if you look at the literature and you listen to what Mark says, that first of all, you got a code that does this. And if you made the code public, then you'd know whether there's a flaw in it. I mean, you could say that the code changes every fifth vote, makes it automatically a Republican vote. You don't, but the point is you don't know. And if you were to make it public, then the vendors say, hey, you can't make it public. You're gonna steal my trade secrets, and furthermore, someone will hack it. And so, geez, we can't do it that way. Then, there must be some way we can have a way of counting the votes backwards, recount, in other words, digitally. After all, they were recorded digitally. We'll have a digital recount. And apparently, when you look at that, some of the commentators say, well, you can't do that because if it backs up, it'll disclose the person who's voted. So. I think your suggestion about the government taking over the process is an interesting one. But just as a layperson, what do you think of all the allegations as to the defect in these machines, which doesn't seem to be able to be cured?
There's been defects in every voting machine. I mean, New York still votes the old machines, which break down every cycle. I'm all for a digital. I've voted digitally. I don't care if there's a paper trail or not. It doesn't bother me in the least. I mean, to me, everybody who my participation in the process has always been to get people to vote, and I try and persuade my voters to make sure they vote and get to the polling place. I want to make sure that their votes are guaranteed and are safe, and I think that there's so much at stake here, in the sense that if you have another election like 2000 and you have a divided electorate today, that the idea that you could have close elections for the foreseeable future, in which the president or the members of Congress who are elected, that there's serious question about their legitimacy, I think whatever the cost nationally is, we should participate in that. And I would hate to go away from digital, but I think there are other ways that, that can perfect it and make sure that the end game is a correct end game.
Now, if we go to your solution, which is not as radical as it sounds, it turns out, if you read all this stuff here, why aren't we going to be back just where we were in the other election, which you said was stolen also?
Well,
I mean, we're going to have hanging chads, we're going to have all the problem, we're going to have 1,000 people sitting in the room, the TV cameras. Something's got to be better than that.
Well, I think that the Republicans, the Bush people, very shrewdly used the images from Florida to argue for the conversion of the voting system to electronic digital machines as soon as possible, because this image of people studying the ballots was spun as a sign of the worst kind of, subjectivity and, slow procedure and so on. But the fact is, there's not going to be any digital or technological fix to this problem. We're talking about elections and human nature. So whatever machinery we use, people are going to find ways to get around it. That the thing that's dangerous about electronic touchscreen machines is there are no votes to count. That fraud can be completely undetectable, you see. Machines, some people think a paper receipt would make a difference. I think that's ridiculous. So what, we're all going to have receipts. What are we going to do with them? The fact is that the machines can be programmed to have your receipt say one thing, and then on the inside, the machine will do something else.
Well, you could have the paper trail. You'd have a piece of paper show up on the screen, and you would accept what the piece of paper said. Some people think that would work.
Well,
you think that could be screwed up by the
any
too.
Digital technology can show you one thing and do something else.
Yeah.
Look, we're all sort of prone to thinking, as good modern people, that progress, technological progress, is always a good thing. It's always the desideratum. Well, maybe for the sake of preserving democracy, it isn't. Maybe a more old-fashioned technological approach with both sides, or all three sides, or however many sides, in on the counting, where everything is transparent, would be the best. For those people who try to silence criticisms of the electronic touchscreen machines, they tend to be Republicans who are happy with Bush, right? Well, what about Venezuela? Hugo Chavez just signed a deal with a company called Smartmatic, which makes voting machines. And because of his close relationship to that company, a number of the conservative parties boycotted the election.
Well,
I don't blame them.
Gentlemen, we've come to the end. So I have to ask you this question. Did the GOP steal the last election?
Absolutely not.
And will they steal the next one?
They won't have to.
I want to shake your hand, Ed Rollins, for coming in.
My pleasure. Thank you
very much.
Thank you.
And Mark, I want to ask you the same question.
Yes.
Yes, yes, yes.
Yes, yes to both.
Thanks a lot for coming in, Mark.
Okay, thank you.
And thank you for coming by to listen to The Digital Age. Come back next week and learn more about the digital age. For that program, I am James Goodale. Good night.